Good morning. My name is Joseph Bass, and today I will be talking about how Discord enables multi-party voice and video for gamers. So first, I'm going to say a few sentences about Discord. I'm pretty sure many of you have not heard about Discord. Most of my talk will be about how we customize WebRTC to meet the needs of our gamers. I have one slide of our selective forwarding unit, and I'm going to close with our challenges and opportunities. Discord was released about 3.5 years ago, and our mission is to bring people together around games. As of August, we have more than 150 million registered users, and the majority of our users actually uses voice and video. Just imagine it's pretty hard to actually use your keyboard or type when you are actually playing the game. And our typical call length is about 30 minutes long, which is pretty much the same as the average time for a game. Our peak is about 2.8 million concurrent voice users, and at that time, we push out about 27 gigabytes of traffic with 115 million packets per second. So it's a pretty big volume. We added video about a year ago, and a growing number of our users actually use video. It turns out that people really like to share their gameplay. And since we target gamers, it's not surprisingly, actually we target mostly PC gamers. It's not surprising that our most widely used platform is Windows desktop. Well, so the slides don't advance as they put it into full screen.
It's
oh, it's still not focused, yeah, right? Okay, so it's going to work now. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So from the very beginning, we had a few design principles. We wanted to do multi-party, because we're mainly interested in multiple people talking to each other by coordinating a raid. This also simplifies our call flow. You can only enter a multi-party session. There is no invites, no outgoing invites that you have to deal with. Since it's multi-party, we need to use a selective forwarding unit. Every call is routed through our homegrown selective forwarding unit. This actually has some very good advantages. Privacy is probably one of the most important. It hides IP address of the users. So you don't have to worry about that. They find out your IP address and they attack you and you can't compete in the game. We also have moderation. Server administrator can disable offending participants. We run on a lot of client platforms. On desktop, as I mentioned, our main platform is Windows, but we support OS X as Linux. We support most of the browsers, Chrome, Firefox, Edge, Safari, and we have an iOS and Android application. The only way we can do that is with code reuse and WebRTC. So on the top, we have our application logic, which is written in JavaScript. From the bottom, we have our customized version of WebRTC, and on top of it, we have our small native library. For our desktop, browser, and iOS platforms, we have something called the MediaEngine.js, which is a compatibility layer or an adapter layer that hides the differences between the browser implementation of peer connection and our own API of native library. For Android, we have a JNI layer, and the application is written in Kotlin, so there is a little bit less code reuse for Android. A very high-level system architecture, you can see that the main entry point to Discord is the gateway. This is a general-purpose gateway using a WebSocket connection, and basically, your server list, your body list, your rich presence, all coming through this gateway. Mostly, you do voice chat through guilds. If you want to do a voice chat, you join a voice channel on a guild server. The guild server will assign you a voice server. It's important to know that our gateway and guilds and most of our signaling running in GCS, but our voice servers are located all over the world, hosted by individual ISPs. We don't use any hosting providers. After the client learned which voice server to connect, it makes a connection to our signaling server through WebSocket to set up the call parameters, and media can start flowing through the SFU. And right now, we only support UDP. So why did we customize WebRTC? And actually, the main reason is that when you use Discord, it's not your main activity. The main activity is your game. So the purpose of the customization is that it really has to work well with your game. And we focus on Windows desktop, as I said. It must work very well on Windows, and most features available first on Windows and then go to other platforms applicable. I took this architecture diagram out of the WebRTC site. So these are the actually part of WebRTC stack that we customize, audio processing, transport, and we added some API to the WebRTC call. So what are the advantages of customizing WebRTC? We can provide the users the features that they want. It also enables us to enhance our server performance. I will talk about it later, how we do that. And finally, I did not mention, but it was in my graph, we use Electron to run our desktop clients, and we are also independent of the version of WebRTC version that ships with Electron. We are on a little bit dated version, which comes with, I believe, maybe with WebRTC 56, so it's well behind. On the flip side, it's pretty expensive to roll a WebRTC version, especially that we use lower-level API that not stable. We also have to interoperate with our web client, which is taken care about our SFU. And on our application, we have to develop our interoperability layer, which is, I mentioned, media.js, that provides a stable API for the application. So the most important customizations were done due to audio. In our client, you can actually select legacy audio, which is nothing more than the legacy Windows multimedia Wave API. About 2.5% users actually enable this legacy audio device. More interestingly, about 15% of the users, Windows Core Audio fails to initialize. In this case, we fall back to Windows legacy audio that just works. We also want to circumvent Windows auto-docking feature, which means that when you use the default communication device, Windows will reduce the volume of other application. Again, Discord is not the main application. It's the game that the main application, so we don't want this to happen. We also implemented our own volume control, and we scale the audio samples by ourselves instead of relying on operating system volume control. We do voice activity detection. I took this chart from this chart is a high level of WebRTC audio processing. I took it from a couple years ago from a Kranky presentation. What is interesting to note here that we take out the pre-encoded audio samples from WebRTC. We perform voice activity detection on it, and we use that to drive our transport layer. We also do sound share. And with sound share, we actually mix the game audio just before encoding. Sound share is only available in Windows, and the reason it's only available for Windows because in Windows, we can inject DLS to the game to get the sound out of it. And actually, it's a pretty hot feature when you do screen sharing without the sound. It's just basically half the experience. Let me talk a few words about our lower layer networking. We don't use the WebRTC peer connection API. We use a lower level API. We directly create audio and video streams. The advantage that we only need to provide very few parameters. The SSRC, the codec payload type, and the transport. For the transport, we provide our own transport. This transport actually implements the WebRTC transport API. However, we do this continuous transmission. So when our voice activity detection algorithm does not detect voice, we don't send audio packets. This has few advantages. First of all, it reduces the bandwidth both on the user and on our server. But most importantly, it significantly reduces our server load since we don't have to process silent packets. And since our main application is multi-party, usually in a multi-party session, there is only one or two speakers. So this is actually a very good gain for us. On the flip side, we do have to take care of the sequence numbering. We also implement our own header extension. For example, the recent priority speaker feature, we implemented it adding certain markers to the RTP header extension. We don't have to use ICE. The main reason is that our voice servers are on public internet and the UDP ports are open to the world. The client sends periodic UDP packets to open the firewall and keep the firewall open even when we don't transmit any audio. We don't need to use SDP, and that probably makes a lot of people happy. Our signaling server allocates SSRC, encryption key, and the codec info. And that's all you really need to set up an audio and a video stream. Of course, when you work in the browser, we do have to do that, but we still avoid sending 5K SDP on the wire. We send minimal information, and our Media Engine JS compatibility layer synthesizes SDP. On the other hand, or it extracts the information from the SDP and sends it to the server. We also opted not to use DTLS SRTP. Instead, we use a SALSA 20 encryption algorithm. This is a stream cipher, very closely related to ChaCha, actually the predecessor of ChaCha, and it was developed in 2007. One very important thing that it's stateless. So that means that we can actually restart our servers without the users noticing any kind of interruption. There is only a few packet lost, which is taken care of by the packet loss concealment. Keys are generated to the server, and besides being stateless, it's also speedier. So this is, I took some measurements on our server without any too much optimization, and it's about twice as fast as AES, which is very important for us because our servers are CPU limited. So finally, a few words about our voice server SFU. It has two components, so signaling part written in Elixir, and the media part is actually written in C++. So the main functionalities of the Elixir component, it monitors the SFU. If it would crash, it just simply restarts it, and the users don't even notice it, or they notice a very minor glitch. It also performs SSRC allocation, so we don't have to deal with SSRC conflict. It generates encryption keys and provides the codec information, mostly the payload type. We also report usage to Datadog, and to be able to interoperate with our browser client, we have to forward speaking indication. Our SFU written in C++, it's an in-house development, and the main functionality, of course, forwarding audio packets for users who are in a given channel, but it also bridges our native and native MINI SDK and our web application. So for work with the web application, it has to interoperate. It has to implement ICE, DTLS, SRTP. For our native client, we implement our own transport. We have to take care of sequence number reordering and our encryption algorithm, of course. For video quality adaptation, it also manages RTCP. And it also performs moderation. If an administrator bans a user, audio packets just simply drop to the floor. As I mentioned, our servers are CPU bound. They are running on pretty generic 4-core hardwares, and we can run about 12,000 users on a given host. They are located all around the world in about 30 data centers. We have about 5-6 providers and 13 regions. This was pretty much my presentation. Finally, our challenges, our opportunities. We collect quality metrics on both client and the server. And just to deal with the sheer number of data, to have our data pipeline up and able to extract quality data is represented a challenge by itself. We use this data to try to find or detect connectivity problems or problems with our servers. We're working on multi-party video quality adaptation. As I mentioned, a very popular use case is streaming your game, and that requires pretty complex algorithms. So finally, for more information, we have an engineering blog that has a lot of interesting articles, and this concludes my presentation. I would like to open with any questions. If you want to talk to me, after, don't want to ask questions publicly. I will be here all day. Just hit me up. Thank you very much.